Distinguished guests, Lord Cobham and Professor Julian Lloyd Webber, governors and trustees, and other esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome on a very wild and blustery night to the opening of our performing arts facilities. It is a tempest out there, so I suppose that's appropriately Shakespearean for us to open this new facility. A very quick piece of housekeeping. In this magnificent new theatre, with every bell and whistle known to man, we also have a marvellous fire evacuation system. The acoustics in here are so good that if we let the alarm off, you would be deafened. So if there is a fire, and we sincerely hope there won't be one, the alarm will not sound, but rather a very well-dressed member of staff will come up on stage and ask you to exit the building in an orderly fashion, and our young people here will point you in the right direction. However, let us hope that that does not happen. You have had a glass of bubbly, and that would be appropriate for the opening of new facilities. We could have just had a drinks function, but we thought, responsible hosts that we are, we thought we probably should provide some food as well as drink. So you're in for a feast this evening. Not the full table, but two tasting platters, one of things dramatic and one of things musical. Some morsels to whet your appetite of what the school has to offer. A half an hour now of a series of vignettes from a variety of dramatic performances. And understand as you watch them that these actors have had at most 2 months, in most cases 2 weeks, and in some cases 2 days to prepare. So I'm sure you will appreciate that. And then at the end of the dramatic performance, and I should point out that each vignette segues into the next, so there's no room for applause until the very end, when a very magnificently dressed tableau will stand poised, hoping that you're going to clap. And at the end of that, the house lights will come up and our ushers will direct you up the rather windswept Performing Arts Avenue to the equally magnificent Ralph Hall, where the second part of our programme will commence. Before we begin, though, I would like to offer a couple of votes of thanks. The first is to the construction firm who have done the remarkable job of the conversion of this, what was once Cobham Hall in our prep school, and as you will see later on, our beloved Ralph Hall in the senior school, and also along the way constructed a new music school and numerous classrooms down here as well. Shayla Group have been absolutely outstanding. We have been building buildings every year in my time and many years before that. I don't think we've ever had quite such a relationship as we've enjoyed with Shayla Group, and I thank them most sincerely. I also offer my absolute sincere thanks to Andrew Haynes, our architect, a visionary in so many ways, but also a keeper of the school's heritage. He is responsible for so many of the buildings you see around the place, and in particular for the harmony between the old and the new. And so I offer him our sincere thanks as well. I thought, before I thank the next person, I would share something I found in the archives. I say I found, the archivist found in the archive for me. This was from a book about the Braziers, who are the famous Bromsgrove building family in the late 1800s and early 1900s, and the quote is thus. This is from 1929, I think. The clearest sign of expansion of the school after the First World War was the building of Ralph Hall by J. and A. Brazier in 1927. By this time, the degree of trust between R. G. Ralph and John Brazier was so great that, on the advice of the headmaster to the architect, no clerk of works was appointed to oversee the execution of the contract. This headmaster is neither so foolish nor so brave, and so he extends his absolute gratitude and admiration to our wonderful bursar, Leslie Brooks, who has been the consummate project manager over the past 18 months. To all three of those contributors, I offer my hearty thanks. In a moment then, your first entree, a smattering from the senior school play that is yet to be performed towards the end of this term, through to Waiting for Godot. We've got a bit of Bollywood in there, we've got some improvisation, we've got some younger children doing mask theatre, all manner of things for you to get a little taste. But before that, it is my great privilege and pleasure to introduce a long-standing friend of the school. In fact, his family friendship goes back over 200 years. The Honourable Christopher Littleton is the 12th Viscount Cobham and the current keeper of Hagley Hall, a man who knows about restoring old buildings, and it is a great, great pleasure to ask, how fitting, Lord Cobham to formally open Cobham Theatre. Lord Cobham.
Headmaster, Professor Lloyd Webber, distinguished guests. There are many members of my family over the years who would have been far better than I to officiate at the opening of the Cobham Theatre. Indeed, once we had abandoned our penchant toward terrorism, evidenced by our involvement in that singularly unsuccessful pyrotechnic experiment that became known as the gunpowder plot, we became moderately useful members of society. Once a game of cricket had been invented, the family confined its competitive instincts to the far safer surroundings of the cricket pitch. My great-great-grandfather, George William, by any standards a considerable polymath, was a leading light in supporting the cause of equality for women in education. He was also, appropriately enough, headmaster, chairman of the Canterbury Association that was behind the first settlements in Canterbury, New Zealand. You might have read a letter in the Telegraph last year by someone claiming to be a member of the first family to field 11 members in a cricket team. They had clearly not read of the great game between the Littleton family, led by George, and Bromsgrove School in Victorian times, when 11 Littletons were fielded, at least 6 of whom had played or were to play first-class cricket. But I digress. George Littleton's son, Alfred, who was a leading politician of his day, was a great supporter of the drive towards a national theatre, and it was his son, Oliver, who saw it came to fruition in 1962, and after whom the Littleton Theatre on the South Bank is named. He was the first chairman. My brother, Richard Littleton, has had a long and distinguished career in the music business, starting at the Birmingham School of Music, the predecessor of the Birmingham Conservatoire. For many years, he was chairman of EMI, or president of EMI Classics, where I believe he became a friend of Julian Lloyd Webber, for whom he clearly has the greatest respect. I spoke to him yesterday and he told me I should congratulate Julian on achieving royal status. I thought that was pretty senior until I realized that he was referring to the Conservatoire and not to Julian personally. So with all these illustrious family members, I have to admit that this is only the second time I've stood on a stage. The other time was at my own prep school in Sussex in the school gym, which was certainly not as impressive as our current surroundings. I had no words, but I brought the house down, literally, by tripping over my big feet and falling through the scenery, and that was the end of my acting career. It's therefore with all due humility that I declare the theatre, Cobham Theatre, open.
Ballyfix, actor, manager, theatrical maestro, with a personal performing repertoire that stretches from the noble Venetian Moor to the poor, preposterous Pantalone, a man who could make you roar, weep, and shudder with an equilibrium of ease. Orlando Ballyfix! A man no less indeed than me. Life and the theatre are almost one and the same.
To tell the truth, when touring the provinces, one increasingly comes to believe that there's no difference at all.
So regularly holding the mirror up to nature, as 'twere, it's all too easy to forget which side of the glass is more natural. This is Porchester, a number 3 fit up, alas, with just a basic pit and no second gallery, and not played in four. Well, quite some considerable time, but still, a theatre! Our extensive and punishing performance schedule over the next 7 nights will doubtless leave an indelible mark upon the whole of this
presently culturally barren society. But for one particular resident, life will be changed forever. Ladies and gentlemen, watch closely tonight. Free your imaginations. And come with me now to the far side of the mirror.
Of mask.
The captain!
And dies.
And tableau!
William! And fate.
Capital! Capital!
Good.
Just watch the positions in the second tableau. Elizabeth, such an ornament.
Mr. Ballyvick.
Oh, Miss Leos! Yet another ornament, of course.
Where's this?
Is it December?
Yes.
Then it's Porchester.
Not altogether inspiring, is it?
Decidedly grim.
Ah, oh, Eustacia! There you are, my angel!
Orlando! Come to my bosom. The fold stands empty in the drowned field, and the crows are fatted with the Morian flock. The nine men's morris is filled up with mud. How long are we playing here?
Only a week, Mother, only a week.
So, if you could see yourself,
yes, yes, do stop going on, girls.
Now, I trust that we are all met.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Unfortunately, there will be a short delay. Owing to the indisposition of our stage manager. Consequently, our accommodation has yet to be clarified.
What?
I have it all in hand. Besides, once we have found it, we can always sleep in a theatre if necessary.
Mr. Ballyvicks, I have played Drury Lane.
Please, the situation is not that desperate. It is merely a matter of locating the nearest hostelry.
Is there an inn?
Well.
Ballyvicks!
Oh, get up and eat!
Yes,
yes! What? I'm an orphan!
Yeah?
We are on a quest!
The shelter! The costumes are to get wet, you see! Can you assist?
What for?
For heaven's sake! We haven't eaten since Winchester! We've had to walk the last 3 miles on account of the overuse of this company's only means of transport and a production of The Wandering Gypsy! It's now pouring with rain! Clippings can't find my umbrella! And unless I receive proper remuneration for that extra business in Brighton, I shall be leaving this dismal town before we even open!
Just somewhere for a weary traveller to rest his aching limbs.
Nothing more than sixpence ahead.
You want the pump, mister?
And where might the pump be, dear boy?
It's 3 cents over the way, isn't it?
Now, the tinker!
Who?
Come then, gallant thespians! These stout mechanicals have declared an accommodation imminently adjacent. But to whom should we sally for?
Whom should we herald?
Who is the proprietor, young man?
Flodden, innit?
Flodden!
Forward to Flodden!
Glums and Cawdor!
Do stop by the playhouse next week.
Both of you, yes!
And entirely... reduced tickets will be available for all of your kindnesses. Thank you.
they then?
It says here, the Orlando Ballyvicks Theatre Company.
What's that then?
Gaw. Theatre. Ain't it marvellous?
Nah, just a bunch of city ponces if you ask me.
Flatten!
Sure, this must be it, Father.
Well, I for one refuse to step any further.
Oh, I have. Quickly, the rest of you. Miss Bitton, do try to keep the costumes dry.
Really,
Orlando, this is too much in one's own talks.
Now, Mr. Fulton, hardly fair to make Mr. Ballinger the weather, is it? As Prospero O'Leary indeed been accused.
There was a roaring in the wind all night. The rain came heavily and fell in floods. But now the sun is rising calm and bright.
Oh, what talent!
What talent?
Mr. Bond.
What? An orphan!
Can I help you, ladies and gentlemen?
Oh, how long we have waited for such kindness.
Oh.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds doth shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a day.
Oh, sir.
Sometimes too hot thee are.
Thank you, Orlando.
There.
Oh, here's our young enemy.
Is it?
Absolutely.
Good evening, my good man.
How do?
Right there, Violet! Stop talking and get on!
Oh, ma, and still they come.
But what might you all be wanting?
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day?
No.
Oh. And you are?
I am what?
We're looking for Mr. Flodden.
Mrs. Flodden.
And where might your good husband be, Mrs. Flodden?
He's on top of the hill.
And will he be back presently?
His present position, madam, has remained unchanged since he was buried quite 10 years ago. So under the circumstances, I very much hope he won't be coming back.
Our deepest apologies, Mrs. Flodden.
He should have died hereafter. If you have tears, prepare to shed them now.
That won't be necessary, gentlemen.
Who is it?
A moment, Pa. Suppose you'll be wanting beds for the night?
Whistles, wine, and
women.
Warmth.
For the week, actually. And the use of a flat iron, perhaps.
The week. And how many are you?
We are but 11. Tableau.
Miss Robin Alears, who's been with us just 2 months.
Too long.
First romance in Dublin.
Charm.
Miss Robin Alovich, first hero heroines, Queen's merch sisters, a splendid merry gamma.
Delighted.
Miss Clifford's first juveniles, dogs, pirates, pages, tumbling, etc. And this is Miss Fitton, who does our wardrobe. Mr. Anthony Hawke, first tragedy. Mr. Bonneville, second tragedy. And Mr. Nevergate.
A complete tragedy.
Who can do everything tragical and comical. And this is my son, Ralph, who's just come in to the tenor lovers. My daughter, Perpetua, who was carried on at the age of just 2 weeks in the siege of Troy and has remained on the stage ever since. And of course, my dear wife, Eustacia, who is everything.
Oh, Len. Mrs. Flodden.
Actors. Well, let dinner be served, sir.
Capital!
Lord, make us truly grateful for every steaming plateful.
Fill my mouth with lovely stuff and nudge me when I've had
enough! Enough!
us truly thankful for this, our daily sustenance, O God. Enable us so to be mindful of thy mercies, Lord. Preserve us from the sin of gluttony, and keep us from the base vice of ingratitude. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And the ladies from the sewing circle are coming this evening to give you some company. Thank you, Switcher, that is all. You're looking paler.
Beggar, it
It was me!
What did you say?
It was me! I killed the little beggar! And he told them how he hit the little beggar with a stick and left him in the marketplace. Don't execute him! Execute me! Release the merchant and execute the tailor!
To kill the little beggar. It was me. It was me. And the doctor explained how to take the little beggar downstairs and dropped him down the chimney of the steward. Don't execute her. Execute me.
Release the tailor and execute the doctor.
Who killed the little beggar? It was me! It was me! And the tailor told how he choked the little beggar with a fishbone and left the body at the doctor's house. Don't behead him, behead me!
I've never hurt the like! Release the doctor and execute the tailor!
I am beginning to come round to that opinion. All my life I have tried to put it from me. Saint Vladimir, be reasonable. You haven't yet tried everything. And I resumed the struggle. So, there you are again.
Am I?
I am glad to see you back. I thought you were gone forever.
Me too.
Together again at last. We would have to celebrate this.
But how?
Get up, Simon Prince.
Not now. Not now.
May one inquire where His Highness spent the night?
In a ditch.
A ditch?
Where?
Over there. And they didn't beat you?
Beat me? Well, certainly they beat me.
The same old as usual?
The same? I don't know.
When I think of it, all these years but for me, where would you be? You'd be nothing more than a little heap of bones at the present minute. No doubt about it.
And what of it?
It's too much for one man. On the other hand, what's the good of losing heart now? That's what I say. We should have followed a million years ago, in the 90s.
Nah, stop blathering and help me off with this bloody thing. Boots must be taken off every day!
Did you ever read the Bible?
The Bible? Well, I must have taken a look at it.
Do you remember the Gospels?
I remember the maps of the Holy Land. Colored they were, very pretty. Oh. The Dead Sea was pale blue. Ooh. The very look of it made me thirsty. That's where we'll go, I used to say. That's where we'll go for our honeymoon. We'll swim. We'll be happy.
Let's go!
We can't.
Why not?
We are waiting for Godot.
Thank you. casino anywhere? Or perhaps have you seen my money? No? Money. Wonderful stuff. More money. Money, money, money. Seems so funny. In a rich man's world.
Pantalone! What on earth are you doing? Picking up the coins of the men off the ground.
I'm collecting.
Collecting?
Yes.
You should be investing. Take me, for example. Investing in many wonderful companies. That's new Waitrose, for example.
Ah, yes. Waitrose. They do fantastic sushi.
Oh, yes.
Yes. And some exotic fruits and vegetables. I do love some kiwi.
Oh, yes, kiwi. Did you know that kiwi is also a bird? Yes. Native to New Zealand. Didn't see many on my travels in Wellington, of course, but I hear that one of them is now running Bromsgrove School.
Ah, yes, I believe you're correct, but unfortunately, Waitrose, it's too expensive for my taste. I like somewhere where you can get a burger and fries for one of these babies. McDonald's.
Yes, McDonald's. Did you know that Bromsgrove is the only town in England where a McDonald's has closed and not reopened anywhere else in the town?
Ah, well, I'm sure you do enjoy a spot of McDonald's from time to time, don't you, old chap?
Their salads are excellent. Although you can't get that much money for your stuff for your money these days, dear fellow. Not since the pound dropped.
Pound drop? Pound drop? Oh,
my dear fellow, not to worry. I am a very experienced doctor. Let me take your pulse. My God, you're dead. I can't hear a pulse at all. How many fingers am I holding up?
Here, doctor, you old fool. I'm perfectly fine.
Well, what I meant, dear fellow, of course, was Brexit and all that EU referendum nonsense. Did you know that the pound...
Boris Johnson is a marvellous fellow. Don't you agree?
Yes, yes, of course, marvellous. He and I studied at Oxford together, don't you know?
Exeter.
Or was it Exeter? Oh, of course. Along the line of McClaws taught there, yes.
Yes, McClaws.
Very good at economics.
Economics.
We learned many things there. We studied business too. Got me investing in many wonderful, wonderful companies. Poundland, for example.
Poundland?
Yes.
Poundland? What is this magical place you're speaking of?
It's right opposite Superdrug.
Take me there at once!
Yes, of course, let's
yes.
go! Right,
Poundland! Money, money, money! Seems so funny! In a rich man's world! Leslie Brooks, I'll see you there! Toodaloo!
Thank you, lucky stars, the three of us can run, so one of us can use it all alone. One last night.
I reckon we've broken into a lull.
Beautiful, is it not? Peaceful?
Peaceful? And what's that dirty great mouth of earth confronting us?
Isn't it an earthwork then? And near enough to protect us.
Yeah. What was that?
Must have been a stray one. All the same, fellas, keep your heads down. You see, the trouble is, we've been fighting too well. We've arrived ahead of ourselves.
How many trenches did we capture, Sarge?
About 9, I reckon.
10?
Make it a round dozen. We'll be mentioned in dispatches.
We'll be heroes. We'll be one up for the Irish Fusiliers.
Yeah.
What was that, Sarge?
What was what?
Sound like someone calling.
Where?
Beyond the mound.
It's a blimey wounded. A lot found that last tack. In that show hole, over there.
There it is again. Come back, come back, you bloody fools.
He's telling us to go back.
Thanks, Mush.
Get back for all that.
Easier said than done.
Shut up! He says we're drawing their fire.
Where did that come from?
Jesus, that was one of ours.
Don't shoot!
Stop! Stop! Stop!
Stop! Now see what you've done, you bloody idiot.
Sarge, what do we do?
You're quick in your pins. Get back to HQ, pronto.
What?
Tell the artillery to raise their bloody sights a bit.
And save their shells for Jerry.
Back through all that?
Yes.
On me own?
We can't lose ground now.
Not unless we haven't come so far.
You do see that, don't you?
Yeah, I see. The battle's won.
Yes.
Sarge, that last shell got the bridge.
Give yourself a treat. Swim for it.
That'll be the first bath he's had in over a year.
Seamus! Bring us by the bottle of whiskey. Irish!
They got him, Sarge!
No!
Right, someone's got to go!
Sure.
Sarge, I could sprint that half mile back in no time.
Get yourself a medal. We've got shots, I'll kill him!
Sarge!
Get down! All of you!
The bloody mad English coming for the next attack!
Don't shoot!
Stop! Stop.
It's not so bad. After all, we've escaped the rest of the whole lousy war now.
Stuff and nonsense anyway, who wants to see a silly play? No, 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 no.